in over the last few hours, we have had to deal with the story of Stacey Ann Campbell, who was killed by a reportedly mentally unstable man in Mayaro. This happened yesterday morning.
Very ugly.
And we've been talking since then, and I heard it raised in the Senate yesterday as well. We've been talking about mental state of people, you know, and how this is treated with by the authorities and so on. And based on what we have been told, and the story is still developing and still evolving, we've been told that this gentleman, this 36-year-old man, was or is mentally unstable. He's now in police custody as they continue their probe. But we do have on the line the public relations officer of the Trinidad and Tobago Association of Psychologists. Her name is Ms. Kelly McFarlane, who she's a clinical psychologist as well. Ms. McFarlane, thank you so much for talking with us this morning. Good morning to you.
No problem. Good morning. Good morning.
I would imagine, like many of us, you would have listened or read with interest this situation in Mayaro. And it makes us question the mental state of people.
Yes, and I think what we look at too is the high levels of stress that people are experiencing now and the ways that we deal with and cope with stress in our society and the resources that we have and don't have to help people cope with stress, you know, and learn how to really regulate their behaviors and their emotions and so on. And I think that is something that is very important for us to take into consideration.
And you talk about the resources, and I often wonder not only if we have enough resources, but are those resources well placed, one? And how do the resources and the authorities and agencies treat with situations like this one?
Yes. Well, firstly, when I talk about resources, no, we have resources in that we have the intellectual resources. We have psychologists, social workers, and so on, a lot of which are paid. People have to pay for and can't afford. As in terms of free resources, that is an interesting question, because a lot of sometimes I talk to people who need help, who need free help, but they're afraid to go for the public help, the public resources, because of their experiences with the public resources. So I think putting more funding and more energy, more consideration into the way we deliver these free resources would encourage people to seek them more. Also, stigma is something that we have to consider, in that people are afraid to go to public hospitals for mental health support because of the lack of privacy and confidentiality and feeling like they're not getting treated the way that they would if they went privately, you know?
And therefore that would make us wonder how many of us walking around acting normal, but not necessarily so normal mentally.
I'll give you a statistic. One in every four persons, this is the World Health Organization, estimates that one in every four people have or will experience a mental health problem. That is a quarter of the population. That is a very high statistic for a very small society. Many of us are walking around with mental health issues, but we don't always talk about it. It comes out in the way that we operate on the job. It comes out in the way that we operate with our families and with our peers, and then it comes out in depression and people eventually exploding.
So just to repeat, sorry, Tony, just to repeat, are you saying one in every four people here in Trinidad and Tobago or worldwide?
It's a worldwide statistic, but also specific to Trinidad and Tobago.
And have you gotten the work done here in terms of the numbers for our jurisdiction?
In terms of mental health problems?
Yes. Yes.
The numbers of what? Well, this is the statistic from the from the World Health Organization. I know the Ministry of Health, there was a statement from the Ministry of Health some time ago in terms of school children, and specifically that one in every six school-age child experiences mental health problems such as depression and anxiety. So that would be the one difference. But generally, one in four is the general safe. I don't think we have exact specific numbers, or maybe happened for a while, but one in four is pretty much what it is.
Are there statistics which speak to out of the one in four, 50% are children, 50% adults, 10% male, 10% female? Are there other more details about this breakout of one in four?
No.
Okay.
No, not that I know of. What we do have more, slightly more specific statistics for is the rate of suicide. We are the third highest in the Caribbean in terms of the rate of suicide. So, and it's completed mostly by males and mostly in the central division. So we do have that, and mostly with people who consume alcohol. So there are things that we could see. There are trends that we can see, and we know that we can pick up from certain trends that people resort to certain things when highly stressed, and some of these things lead to other behaviors such as suicidal behavior and so on.
Now, certainly this incident in Mayaro, we are still learning of it, and I'm sure there's still a lot of information we don't have, but I'm just wondering, how do you treat with somebody who you know to be mentally unstable and or you know to have mental health issues? I'm trying to use the right kind of dialogue, word and language. How do you treat with such a person? Because here is a case based on one of the several of the reports that we have read on this Mayaro situation, where the person lives next door to the victim, and there was just an attack that seemed to have come from nowhere. How does one deal with somebody who may be a close relative or who may be a neighbor? How do you keep your distance? What do you do? How aware should you be?
No, I wouldn't advise to keep your distance. If it is someone that you are close to, you see signs that the person is you know, struggling with their mental health, first of all, talk to them about it. We don't want to avoid it, right? Find a way to have a conversation. Tell them what you've noticed. Tell them the symptoms or the signs that you've noticed. You know, I've noticed you've been feeling this way or acting that way, and ask them if they would like you to intervene and get them some help, offer them some help. People are often very reluctant to get help. It depends on what the mental health struggle that the person is dealing with, right? Because some mental health struggles, the person does not have insight. They can't see that something is wrong. So everybody else can see it. So then in some cases, you yourself, as a caring family member or friend, might want to seek help on their behalf. When all else fails, you go see the psychiatrist and explain to the psychiatrist, listen, my sister, my brother, my cousin, my neighbor is exhibiting these symptoms, these behaviors, and I fear that he or she would do something that would endanger themselves or someone else even more. Let this professional advise you how to handle that further. Right, and how to talk to the person, how to coach the person, and because there are certain ways that you have to speak to somebody who is experiencing a mental health problem. You don't want to push them away further. You don't want to make them feel fear for stigma and feel judged, because when someone tells you that you have a problem, that you seem to have to be mentally ill, especially if we don't say it in a very sensitive way, the first thing someone might become is defensive.
Yes.
They might be afraid that you would run away from them, or others would run away from them if they see or
because we can easily dismiss. We can easily dismiss somebody as a madman. He mad, or she mad.
Right.
You know?
The language.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
May I ask, in terms of availability of medicine at the public institutions, ever so often we read of shortages of certain drugs. As we speak, what's the status, to the best of your information, medicines for persons who are challenged mentally?
I don't have much information on that, to be honest, at this particular point in time. I do know that I do know that some, let's say, some people that I see have some problems getting some medication for sometimes, but that's as much as I could really speak on that.
But would they be seeking your intervention because of the lack of medicine at the public institutions, or is it because they prefer to see you privately?
No, it's because psychotherapy and psychiatry complement each other.
Mm-hmm.
So you could have an issue and you can get medication to help you deal with the symptoms
right.
in the moment, right?
Mm, okay,
but
understood.
Psychotherapy goes deeper to help you really actually bring the real issues to the forefront and then deal with them, cope with them, get rid of them, kind of control them.
Without a diagnosis, how does one recognize that there may be a mental health problem at home?
How does the person with the mental health problem realize that they themselves are ill, or the family members?
Family members.
You'll definitely see symptoms. So let's say the person is depressed. They may suddenly lose interest in things that they were interested in. They may communicate less with their family members. They diet changes in energy levels, unable to sleep well or sleeping too much. So you will see behavioral changes for sure. Once something is a problem, and then, because you see, we're not just talking about somebody being a little down because they're having a bad week. We're talking about a mental health problem. The symptoms will be there. And what we have to do as family members is not be in denial. Because things like depression and so on, it starts with the symptom set. But when it turns in, when it becomes a depressive disorder, it is chronic. So we want to try to nip things in the bud, just like we deal with physical diseases or illnesses. We want to try to get it at the beginning, at its onset. You also want to do the same with mental health problems. So we need to not be in denial, and we need to talk. We need to have the conversations with our family members.
So would a depressed person be categorized as a mentally challenged person?
Mentally challenged, you mean mentally ill? Yes.
Because depression, yes. In some cases, depression leads to, or is it at a certain point you can come back off of depression? I'm just trying to get a sense, what is the line? Yeah. What is the line that you can describe?
You can be, okay, so depression is a symptom of a mental health problem, of a mental illness, right? So in the DSM, which is the statistical manual that professionals use to diagnose, we have depressive disorders, right? They have major depressive disorders, psychothymia, and so on. So one symptom of those disorders is depression. So yes, you can become depressed at a point in time, maybe let's say due to grief or breakup or something. But when when the symptoms get exacerbated or they go on for very long, then we can diagnose a depressive disorder or a mental illness. And when it, because you asked if it goes away, depression is chronic, so it never, you don't really cure depression, but you go into remission. So you can learn to cope with your depression, and you can learn to manage your symptoms.
Ms. McFarlane, thank you very much for the information.
You're very welcome. Right.
And thanks again. Have a good day.
Mm-hmm. You too. Mm-hmm.
Clinical psychologist Kelly McFarlane, who is also the public relations officer of the Trinidad and Tobago Psychologists Association. And we thank her very much. All right. Let's take some calls.